Hello, hello. I'm Johnny Jungle Guts, the top-notch gamer, aka the top-notch gamer. And today we are doing Let's Gay. Today on my show, my guest is my very dear friend, John Bartle. Thanks so much for being on the show, John.
Thanks for having me, Johnny.
John's a little tired today.
I am, but I am very happy to be here.
He's a little hungover, but we're gonna get into it right now.
Do it.
What have you been up to this weekend?
This weekend, let's see. Friday, I hung out with David. That was good. And yesterday, went to see some arts. Saw Paul Pescador had a show at Vacancy. So I went over there and checked that out. I hadn't been to that gallery, so that was... It was nice to go somewhere new.
Sounds good.
And then got some good food.
Sure.
Then went and had some like after show celebration time.
Yeah.
Then
that's where the hungover part started to come into play.
I think it was the whole time, but that's where maybe it got
ramped up.
You took
it to the next level.
Yeah. But and then we went to the show at Human Resources. The bedroom, internet discount bedroom number 2.
Sure. They had some copies of, they had the Dreamcast there, I saw.
Yeah, but did you ever get into Dreamcast?
Oh, I loved Dreamcast. I still think that Dreamcast is, well, I don't really think that this. I think a lot of game people feel a lot stronger about this than I even do in terms of Dreamcast's sort of general influence on games, specifically fighting games, because Marvel vs. Capcom 2 and also Soul Calibur both were Dreamcast games, and they are probably the two greatest fighting games ever made.
Some
in a lot of people's minds.
Some top-notch fighting games.
Yes. So that was exciting, and it was exciting to see
the Dreamcast is still out there.
Yeah,
and getting manhandled.
Mm-hmm. Crazy Taxi. I don't know if you remember that game.
I don't.
That game is a taxi driving simulation where you have to drive people to their destinations. The soundtrack is mostly by the band The Offspring.
Wow.
So it's quite, it's a pretty,
sounds crazy.
It's a pretty crazy taxi ride you end up going on Crazy Taxi. So today on Let's Gay, my number one goal is to defeat Doomgaze, which is a roving, flying monster that we will just randomly encounter by flying around in our little airship here that you see. So that's my goal for today, and we'll see if we accomplish that, but,
what is your conflict with Doomgaze?
Ask him. He's the one who keeps attacking us as we're flying around. But I guess now we're the ones looking for him. Previously, up until this point in the game, that had not been the case. But I feel like that it's kind of gotten to that point.
Something's got to be done.
Something's got to be done, and I'm sure something special has got to be unlocked by me. That's why I'm so set on it. Maybe there's a little tip in here that says the best way to... Doomgaze's enemy you may have encountered before, it attacks your party on a rather frequent basis while you're flying your airship around the world. At times it may seem like it takes forever to encounter, but you always do eventually.
Ah.
Well, we've got time to kill. It's the perfect thing to have to do while we're talking. John, just so everyone knows, is an artist himself. He is heavily embedded in the LA art scene and has been for many, many, many years.
Okay.
I don't know what more to say than I don't know how to sum up everything that you do. I guess you're an art. I think you're always involved in some degree of arts organizing.
I would say I do a lot with other people.
A lot of collaboration.
I work with a lot of different people in different kind of extents. You know, like sometimes it's a very intimate kind of like one-on-one or like very small group where all decisions are kind of being made together, And then there's things like, yeah, that are maybe more organizing, where it's like, maybe like inviting a lot of people to do something, and then they kind of have a lot of free room within that to do their own thing, and I'm not necessarily involved with those decisions.
Sure.
And then there's also kind of more like large collective projects like Kchung or Eternal Telethon, where it's like the way in which I'd work with people maybe like differs very much from person to person and moment to moment.
Sure.
I mean, you've been involved with a lot of those projects.
I have. Would you like to describe those two specifically, maybe? Kchung and the Eternal Telethon?
Well, I feel... Do you want to? I don't really want to.
You don't want to? Okay, well then I'll give it a shot.
Okay.
The Eternal Telethon is a series of webcasts designed to raise money for an artist retirement community, and also to just give artists a community sort of in that moment of doing the Eternal Telethon. A lot of the telethons have been very long.
The last one that both of us were very, very involved with was 60 hours?
Yeah.
At Human Resources.
It was intense, and it was trying, and there was tears, and there was laughter, but I will say that at the end of it, I felt very sort of re-edified in terms of my knowledge of what maybe was some of the things going on in the LA creative community.
Yeah, especially in terms of performance.
Specifically, the performance, performance art realms of Los Angeles, and... there was a lot of really standout performances and some real surprises. One of my favorite performances was a performance in which a man removed gluten toxins from other people's bodies. It was really...
with just their hands.
With just their hands.
I mean, their hands and their special powers.
Their special powers, too. That really blew me away. There was a lot. There was a lot to see.
There was a lot. There was, yeah, and so, like, I mean, using that as an example where maybe, like, you know, at one moment, either of us might be, like, being the camera person for somebody's performance. At another moment, we might be like following their instructions during the performance.
Might be literally in the performance.
Might be kind of just like out there by yourself and everybody else is like outside or something. But yeah, I would say I really tend to gravitate towards spaces like that are really dynamic and can have different types of interactions with people.
Yes. Yes, you definitely play many roles when you are an organizer, I guess showrunner, you might call it, for the Eternal Telethon. The other, and it's, we could do a 5-hour podcast just talking about all the different kinds of performance art we've seen on there, from balloon popping to really intense dialogues about social issues and personal experiences to some
TED Talks, air guitar.
Whatever you can imagine people doing in front of a camera without any editing has kind of, a lot of it has happened. A lot has happened.
But I think, I still believe there's a lot more.
There's so much more. There's so much more. I guess there's never been live sexual
on screen,
but in the vicinity, in the immediate vicinity of the broadcast, there certainly has been sexual interludes have occurred.
What was the first Eternal Telethon that you got involved with? How did that happen?
Wow. I'm having a hard time remembering I would say the very first one I felt that I remember feeling very involved with was on York Boulevard at Barf Space in Highland Park. And I did some performances at that. And then after that was I went to South America for a little while, but when I came back, I remember getting very heavily involved in the telethons for a good 1 or 2 years.
Right, especially like video editing at that point.
I was doing a lot of video editing then. I got a new computer just to video edit it, but now computer is out of date, and I can't use it. Now I can't use it to video edit really anymore. It's sad. Time flies by really fast.
Especially when you're a computer.
The other project that John briefly mentioned was Kchung Radio. Kchung is a volunteer-run radio station, and in a lot of ways, that kind of sums it up. It's based here in Chinatown. We've done a lot of different sort of events, though, and collaborative projects with music and also some performance art, but the focus in general often seems to be sound. Though we did a TV station once as well. We had a Kchung TV for a summer.
Yeah, and we did a book.
Which was kind of a I feel like we've done a couple books.
That's true. I was thinking specifically of the one that, like, me and Greg Rubin put together. It was Kchung Volume 1.
Kchung Stories?
No, that one too. That was like a year ago. Maybe 2 years ago. There's also the calendar that Austin took the photos for. Most of my publishing experience is through Kchung with, like, print media.
Yeah.
It's like that, and me and John Barlog did some zines, Citizens Promoting a More Pleasurable Public.
Yeah.
But yeah, most of my publishing. So now working on your collected writing.
That's right.
That's all those experiences are coming into play or helping me navigate this. Try to navigate this now.
But what I really want to talk about is this. This idea of collaboration in art, because I remember maybe 5 years ago, I want to say.
2011.
Maybe it was 2010. 2009, I really had this feeling that art in general, visual art and just sort of, let's just go under the blanket of the art world, even though the art world, it's hard to define. Because it was moving in a direction that was very interested. It seemed like it was moving in a direction where collaboration was becoming more valued than it had been in the past, because it's much easier to categorize, define, and then sell art when it's created by a single creative godlike entity. And I thought that maybe was like, collaboration was the future of art, and I, you know, saw you as a part of that because you do work collaboratively so often. And now it doesn't. I was wrong. I feel like I was wrong about that.
Well, I mean, I think, I think it's hard to talk about, like, kind of like evolving trends within art worlds. At this point, because there's so many art worlds.
Yeah.
So, like, you know, in a lot of places, modernism is really valued and is still, like, cutting edge. To other places, in other, like, conversations, that's considered very, like,
offensive.
Outdated, yeah, if not offensive. But, you know, like, I think there's the market for, like, high-end, one-of-a-kind luxury goods isn't going anywhere anytime soon, and like the speculative, like, art market isn't going anywhere, and both of those systems reward, like you said, it's like individual, you can put together a narrative about their practice, and like, you know, where like this happened and this happened, it seems like a very logical perspective, like evolution that is rewarded. But I mean, partly, I like working in different capacities and with different people and underneath different you know, brand names or like names or however you want to say that as a way to really complicate that singular narrative, because it's like everybody that's like thought about this stuff seriously knows that like narrative progression in somebody's work is very like fabricated and not very honest. And I think just having a lot more tangents and a lot more ways to think about somebody's work in the long run is, like, I appreciate that as a viewer. And so it's a little bit harder to follow, like, the overture or whatever. And it, maybe, you know, like, you really like somebody's, the things that they did at this specific time or whatever, or... But and not so much the other stuff, but I'm okay with all that.
Sure.
But so I would say like there's probably as many people working together, if not more, now. But maybe it's just like at that moment it was framed in a different way, or you were seeing things more often.
Yes.
I mean the last Hammer Biennial show that had like a lot of group work in it and a lot of people that worked with other people even if they were showing their individual work.
Sure.
This one I think has far less, but all those, I wouldn't say that it's really, from my perspective, it hasn't really decreased. It's just who's getting included, you know?
Yeah, I think so, and I think you're right. I was probably just around a lot of people who were working collaboratively at that time, and that's why I saw that as a future trend. But
it might also be like you're a little bit older. You're like 5 years older now, so maybe a lot of your peers are thinking a little bit more seriously about how to you support themselves.
I certainly am.
And so, you know, working with other people is hard. Like, I've had so many projects where we've been working on something for a long time, maybe years. A friend of mine was working on a film with somebody for 3 years, and then they, like, moved to a different state, and were just like, yeah, I'm done with this. And, like, it's hard to think about building your career or, like, a financially stable career with that type of, like, instability at play.
The instability of another person.
Yeah.
Specifically, not a company or a... I mean, those are unstable, too, I guess.
But that's a little different because the company is built up often to exist, to be larger than any one person, right?
Sure. But, and you also in the past for a long time, but, you work, make individual artwork as well, and you explore that.
Yeah, I mean, I think, I think everybody does, you know, even somebody that might be in a very, like, you might think of as being in, like, always producing art as a duo or something.
Sure.
Or in like in a certain way, everybody probably like makes some little drawings or some, you know, like, you know what I mean? Like, I feel it's a lot easier, and like at a certain point I felt like it was really important to make the stuff that I did by myself visible, because I wanted to kind of like share that with people. Yeah. what I do, and maybe it would give people a different way to think about the work with other people. I think it was also a little bit too, like, I think I really started painting like a lot more seriously when my dad was in the hospital. I was like spending a lot of time in Long Beach.
Yeah.
So I just wasn't around other people.
Other artists.
I wasn't around other artists that I had like a dialogue with.
Sure.
Yeah.
And did that help you a lot, cope with your dad being sick and passing away and all that stuff?
Maybe. I mean, I'm sure it did. I don't remember, like, observing that in a kind of, like, graspable way.
Sure.
But in retrospect, yeah, I'm sure it did.
Yeah, because you were... You did quite a bit of drawing during that time.
Yeah, I did. I've been making a lot of drawings now, but nobody's... I'm not experiencing that type of emotional, like...
Right!
...grief. But that's... This summer, I made, like, 60 postcards or something. That's
wow! Have you sent all those out?
Sent, like, half of them. Sometimes I like to stretch it out, so, like... I like to hang on to them for a little while, or if I'm sending multiple to a certain person, I like to have it maybe over a couple weeks.
Yes.
So they get to kind of, like, experience the postcards in small groups or individually, and then put them together.
Yes, I find your postcards very difficult to describe. There are moments of abstraction, moments made sometimes of representation, very bright colors. But what draws you to that specific location of the postcard as a site for art making?
I think one thing is that it's like an object that circulates in the world in a way that a lot of drawings aren't.
Mm-hmm.
So it gets, like, you pick it up, it's a one-of-a-kind drawing that, and sometimes, like, I've labored over for, like, a while, so you aren't, like, it's not so precious, though, because it's gone through the mail, and maybe it's gotten a little smudged, or was in the rain, or, the corner's bent, so, like, some people frame them, you know, some people put them on their fridge, I'm sure sometimes, you know, people just throw them away.
Oh.
Or sometimes they don't get to the people.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
I guess that's just an inevitability of the mail, huh?
And I don't put a return address on them, so if they do that, then that's just kind of what happens. But yeah, I think it's like that... I mean, partly that's like a queer thing for me, too, where it's like you don't know what to do with them. They don't really fit into any specific... form, right? Because if you get them framed, then it's, you don't see the back,
right?
So they kind of, like, don't fit into any, like, clearly defined way to handle a drawing.
Mm-hmm.
And I like that.
But you just used the term queer to discuss something that maybe is not,
it's not sexual.
Sexual. Describe, because I've been seeing that more and more just in general, in the world. Describe maybe a little bit more what you might mean by that.
Like there's a definition for queer that I think is like from what's his name? Jose Esteban Munoz. He's like a queer theorist.
Sure.
Who I haven't read a ton of, but I've, like, read a little bit, but there's this one way that he defines queer, which is, like, queer can never, like, help to define something. It can only complicate a definition of something.
Sure.
And I think that what he's getting at there is that queerness is about, like, things that kind of don't fit comfortably into labels or predetermined boxes.
Sure.
And I totally, like, identify that in a lot of ways where, like, that's a helpful word for me to have when describing, like, the way I experience reality.
Yeah.
And in a lot of ways, like, different parts of my art, because, like, yeah, I think a lot of what I do is maybe doesn't fit clearly into, like, the kind of, like, cornerstone art practices that maybe that 15 or 20 years ago, that when I was, like, first kind of introduced to contemporary art, like, didn't really, like, none of those practices have kind of lined up with what I do.
Sure.
Or at least were presented in a way to me like that, right? So, like, there aren't a lot of people that I know that are, like, examples of of people, of artists working with other people as much, or if they are, it's usually with like a very specific group that didn't really do things outside of that group, or the work they did outside of that group is invisible. Or like people that
Let's get into some specifics here. Who specifically might you be talking about?
I don't think that there is, like, though. Like, you mean specific examples of, like, duos or something?
Sure.
Well, like, I think one of the older ones that comes to mind is the two German dudes that did The Way Things Go.
What's their name? For those of you who don't know, that's a video piece, I guess you could say, that's sort of like, I don't know how I would describe it other than it's sort of like just a series of events, machines that sort of interconnect with each other to interact with each other and cause things to happen. It's sort of like, I can only think of like the board game Mousetrap right now when I'm trying to describe it.
But like those are two artists that work together for decades, and you know, they're like, there's examples of people I know that did that, but there wasn't a lot of examples that were laid out for me where it's like, oh, somebody like that was in a band and then they ran this space and then they made paintings and then they, you know, did like a lot of different things at different times with different people that didn't fit into like a singular kind of like, this happened and then they did this. And you know, like I feel like that is partly just the way history works, where it gets kind of simplified and reduced.
Yeah.
But, so I don't know. For me, thinking about, like, queerness as a thing that, just doesn't really, like, fit into pre-existing archetypes, maybe?
Sure.
I mean, how, like, you were saying you feel like you've seen other...
Well, we talked about it on the very second episode of my show with Will Johnson, Will You Are Not, and he talked about queerness as being just anything that he talked about a lot of what you're talking about, that queerness isn't necessarily tied to sexuality or gender, or doesn't have to be. Though people who have some sort of divergent stuff going on in that realm often do queer things in other areas. And that was the first time I really felt like I'd heard that verbalized by someone I knew, but I had a suspicion that was sort of where the identity of that word was going.
Right. Because, like, do you think of people that are heterosexual that you identify as queer?
I think I can think of people who I think of as heterosexual identify themselves as queer, but...
Wait, people that they self-identify as queer and you feel weird about that?
Yeah, maybe, but that's different than what you're talking about. I see queerness in this video game just in, like, you know, the way in which masculinity is sometimes portrayed.
Right.
And especially when you're interested in a lot of media, like comics and video games, where there was not historically and is only now starting to be any real queer representation. Well, actually, I mean... Queer representation in comics history is actually a little bit more debatable. But for the most part, all the characters perform heterosexual ways of being.
Right.
I think that that you look for, as a gay guy, I always looked for sort of symbols or indicators of difference that were not explicitly there.
Was there any comics where, like, somebody has Iceman had like the bandana out the back pocket.
No, I mean, this is the thing with comics, and specifically superhero comics, that I've been really thinking about more and more lately, which is that Superman is a man in extremely tight-fitting, excessively bright clothing.
Right, yeah.
That is...
He's wearing a fucking cape.
That is also completely impractical. Okay? The cape is completely impractical. But because Superman and Batman have become so ingrained in our American history and our American culture, we've sort of forgot what that is. We've sort of forgot that there's a slight deviancy there right away. Like, if Superman didn't exist in culture and I saw that walking down the street or in a drawing, I would have some questions. And also even in like the what was the one? The first the later ones weren't as big of offenders of this, but the very first Christopher Nolan Batman movie, where, you know, there wasn't really any supervillain figure, and there wasn't really... It was, like, a lot of mob bosses and stuff like that, and it was all very realistic, and it's sort of like... I felt like everyone had kind of forgotten what we came here for, which was a guy in full leather gear and a bat mask solving completely absurd and surreal mysteries. Like, that it was over the top, that it's not supposed to seem... realistic.
Right. I think that was also... I mean, I think you're totally right. With that specific film, I feel like it might have been a little bit about... Or, like, the... A little bit about, like, the special effects or lack of quality special effects that led to why they would do a film like that.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I get what you're saying. And I had definitely never thought about, like, yeah, how... I mean, if I was to see somebody in just it doesn't even have to be that different, you know? Like, if you saw somebody in more or less, like, that outfit, but it was just a little bit different, like, the colors were a little different, I would be like, whoa, that guy's going to party hard.
Yeah.
Like, he's got those big shiny boots on, and he's got his bright underwear on the outside.
Yeah, it's a lot. It's a lot. Really a lot. And I feel like because it's become so ingrained in the culture, we've kind of forgotten that. Right. And obviously it's existing in a lot of ways outside of, because it sort of existed before, our sort of contemporary discourse around the way we talk about sex and sexuality and gender expression. But it still is incredibly divergent from
right,
culture.
Yeah.
But anyway, let's not tarp on gay superheroes. But yes, the definition of queer feels ever expanding all the time, and I'm constantly struggling to
keep
up. I'm feeling
just
like
go
an
with
old,
the flow, man.
An old
just,
gay.
Just ride the wave.
Yeah. Well, that was easy. We just knocked out that dragon. So what else can we get into? So you grew up in Long Beach.
Long Beach, yep. Lived there till I was 18. It was good.
So that's still more than half your life.
Yeah. Almost two-thirds. It was good. I, like, spent a lot of time with the water and the beach.
Very Californian. Some surfing.
Yep. Swim, a lot of time in pools, swimming, swim coach, water polo.
Sure.
A lot of, like, making, like, homemade wraps when I was a kid.
Wow, that's like really good.
Yeah.
I got into that, too, because I grew up by a river.
By the river, right.
For what purpose were you making the homemade rafts?
Just for fun, to get to the other side. There was a bay.
Oh, there was a bay.
Yeah, so, like, I mean, like, now, or, like, even when I was, like, a teenager, I could swim across it, no problem. But, like, when I was really young, it seemed really far, and so I would make, like, little rafts.
And were you, you were a kid who your mom let you roam free a little bit.
Oh man, yeah. I was
unsupervised.
Unsupervised time, yeah. Both my parents worked.
Yeah.
And so that was a big part of that, I think. So like I think that's also a big part of why I worked as a swim coach or like was around the pool so much is like where other parents might want their kids to be home for dinner, you know, like my mom might be just getting off work, so like the idea of me like hanging out at the pool and then going out to dinner with like the other staff and then like me coming home at like 8, like fed and tired, was probably great for her.
Yes, yes.
And like yeah, I think, and then like when my parents got divorced, it was like a lot of, that was probably even more so, and yeah, I spent like a lot of time, you know, watching TV, playing video games, like skateboarding.
Slacker pursuits.
Like when I was older, it like, that's also probably a big part of why I got so into art, you know, is like, I had a lot of free time. That wasn't structured, or like I could do whatever I wanted with.
Sure.
And I think maybe kids that it was a little bit more set up for them, they might have not been had like that kind of like self motivation or something.
Yeah.
And like I think that's still really relevant to how I live.
Absolutely, I think it is. You're one of the few people I know from art school who has stayed in art.
And like I still, and I would say you too, like still like self-initiate a lot of projects, which there are a lot of artists that don't do that. It's like they might produce the things on their own and kind of from their own, what's that, fruition? Is that the right word?
Sure.
But they might not like get the show together or like go to a park and put everything out for and invite people, or like whatever that is, whatever that way of distribution is, put it online.
Yes.
You know,
because when you're a creative, you're also always, you always have to be, if you're really gonna distribute that work, you have to get good at distributing the work.
Or find somebody else that's gonna do that, or it just stays in your world, like your possession. Maybe your friends come over and see it, and there's definitely a lot of amazing artists that work like that.
Absolutely.
But I would say we're both in the camp where like we kind of think about like, how is this gonna get out, where am I, do I need to write a proposal, do I but that free time, I mean, so that also like I spent a lot of time gardening and like not going to school my senior year.
And gardening, like, yeah.
And those are all just ways that manifested. My art teacher my senior year was really supportive. Like he kind of knew that I was on my own track and would let me ditch class, like my other classes, and just go to his class and paint or draw or whatever. Or sure. Like come in halfway through the day with like clearly I just came from my house and drop off a painting or whatever. And I kind of remember one other student being like trying to do it and him being like, what are you doing, you can't ditch class and hang out.
Oh, and the favoritism.
They were like, he does it, and he was like, yeah, but he's not, he's like doing his own thing. And
oh yeah, I love that. I love when you just get a teacher.
I might have already been in like gotten accepted to CalArts at that point, probably. Sure.
And how was that whole experience for you?
Well, I met you, so
that's how there must have been.
Makes it worth it.
One good thing that happened at CalArts.
It was great for me. Like a lot of, maybe like 3 or 4 years ago, I kind of pulled most of my friends that I had gone to undergrad with. And I was shocked how many people... So the question was, did you have more fun making art before or after school? And I was shocked that I was, like, one of the, if not the only person that said, art for me was way more fun after school. Like, for me, it just got opened up. It gave me, like, vocabulary and, like, frames to think about things in ways that were, like, meaningful and I got really excited about. It gave me, like, showed me all these different references that I didn't know.
Sure.
But I think for a lot of people, that program, it's so critical that it kind of, like, takes the fun out.
Yes, I think for a lot of people, they become worried that they become overcritical of their work and they become a little paralyzed.
Yeah, it's too much scrutiny. It's too much, like, yeah, paralyzed is definitely the right word. Where they, like, would have an idea but wouldn't do it because...
They found a thing that was wrong about that. That was
right.
problematic with the work.
But I just feel like there's a problematic with everything.
That's, yeah, that's how I felt.
You kind of just, like, I think I had certain teachers that, when undergrad, that would be like, oh, yeah, this work is really great. And then other ones that would be like, this is really bad, you need to stop doing this. And so really early on, I kind of got that it was a very, like, subjective experience, you know?
Yeah.
And that was helpful for me. It just made me take everything with, like, a grain of salt, you know?
Yeah.
I also think I was, like, stoned so much that a lot of stuff I just forgot.
Yeah.
You know? Like, a lot of really harsh feedback that maybe would stick with other people.
Oh, it stuck with me. I think I did the exact opposite thing of you, where I literally was so, like, I just wanted all my critiques to just go great. And I can't even say I was unsuccessful at that, but that's probably not a great way to approach it.
Yeah, I had horrible critiques. Horrible. Oh my gosh. There was one where, like, Liz fell in the mud and Leslie got a sunburn. And, like,
I remember hearing about that. That was legendary.
That was so bad. But, I mean, also that I was making work with other people. Like, I was, especially with John, like, that whole body of work was made with John Barlog and Ben Lowry, and mm-hmm. I think being able to, like, talk with another person, it kind of, like, made the critique, like, outside of yourself, in a way.
Yeah.
Yeah, that, so, as opposed to, like, if it was just me, then it's like I'm presenting myself, and then they're criticizing me,
mm-hmm.
you know?
That's how I always took it.
Which is, like... Yeah, I don't know if that's the most productive.
Do you want to talk a little bit about some of that work?
Sure.
Because I have a fond memory. I have a fond memory of it.
Oh, what comes to mind for you?
Well, I remember being... Let me think of some specific pieces. You were still in school. Just so everyone knows, John has a square-shaped... tattoo on his arm. Were you still in school when that was installed, or,
yeah,
or no?
Yeah, so that's like 2006 or 2007.
Do you want to describe that project a little bit?
Yeah, so it's a rectangle tattoo on my left forearm. John Barlog, I got the tattoo with. We both have them, got them at the same time. And the space functions as a gallery, exhibition space, where anybody can do a show. It's very open. If anybody listening would like to do a show, you can write me at let's do John at kchungradio.org.
Mm-hmm.
We'll set it up. We'll make it happen. But so that work, I think a lot of what me and John, well, there's definitely different avenues or different, like, threads to the work we made together, but, there's several projects that were about, like, taking a space and trying to, like, utilize it, a space that maybe isn't being utilized, and trying to, like, give it more purpose.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, some of those were, like, taking free, like, the kind of, like wooded kind of, like, islands that are off freeways.
Yeah.
Off freeway and off ramps, and, like, creating chicken coops there that would be, like, kind of run by different people, and kind of different people would take care of them and could eat the eggs, or covering up billboards.
And how long were those able to stay up for, those freeway chicken coops?
I think the longest one was like 4 to 6 months.
Wow.
There was like a billboard on the corner of the school that we had like gave different artists at the school big signs that we'd hang it for them over the billboard.
Sure.
Or like building a platform in a different billboard so like people could go up and hang out like in the middle of it. Like a little like kind of like kind of clubhousey secret zone. But so the tattoo I'd say like came out of that, and it still is great when people do things. I get really excited. I just today had a Facebook showed me that a year ago, Emi Kuriyama did a piece that was really great where she made a photo negative of a photo of the sun and then put it on, and then there was like a poem around it, and then it would tan onto the skin.
Yeah.
It's been a lot of performances that have been done, a lot of drawings. You did a drawing?
I did a drawing,
Alex,
yes.
The parrot, I think?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I drew Alex the parrot, who is a parrot, those of you don't know, who could speak English.
Was it something about a strawberry?
Alex, when Alex didn't know certain words, he would make portmanteaus of them. It's hard to just believe this parrot could really fully speak American or the English language with about an 800-word vocabulary, and correctly assign the words to
smart parrot
to objects and numbers. But when he didn't know the word for something, he would often make portmanteaus. Like, for example, when he ate an apple, he called it a bannery because it was red on the outside, like a cherry, but yellow on the inside, like a banana.
So yeah, that was a lovely show that we had.
Mm-hmm.
I'm kind of thinking about like having somebody else curate it.
That's fun.
Because I feel like that's happened a couple times and it works really well, but mostly it's like I'm just spread too thin and kind of I spend a lot of time on that, like running that as a space and like connecting with artists and making the shows happen. And I kind of had to like focus on other things for a while. And
yeah.
Now I'd really like to have more happen, but I just don't feel like I have the time and energy to facilitate it. So maybe having an outside curator.
That would be good. That would be fun.
Make it happen, but yeah, some other work that me and John did. We did a whole show at CN Space Explorations coming. It kind of stemmed out of the tattoo gallery. Did you go to that?
I did not get to go to that. I went to. No, I don't think I did get to go to that.
It was fun. CN Space was a great artist-run gallery in Highland Park, I think from like 2007 to 2010, 2006, 2009 or something.
It was blink and you'd miss it, but a lot of cool stuff happened.
And this is the first show I did out of school. That was cool.
That's always a big moment, having that art show that is not at school and is after school and everything.
I like this guy. Who's he?
He is some kind of giant, I think. The animation of his crotch is fascinating.
Yeah,
to me.
That definitely caught my eye. And those thighs.
The thighs are meaty.
Yeah, so CN Space, Lara Bank, who ran that, definitely deserves a lot of credit. Yeah, now John, I mean, he's becoming a doctor.
He's becoming a doctor, and you moved on to some other amazing art projects, like your radio show on Kchung, No, with Guan Rong.
Uh-huh, you were on just last week.
That's right.
That was fun. That's like the, maybe, well, I remember you were station managing. Since we've been in the third floor space, that's probably like the second or third time you've been on. I was trying to think.
I was on the 420 holiday special.
I remember that. That was a good show.
I was on the holiday special for 420, and that was a lot of fun. I definitely was really loud. And then I was on definitely at least one other time that I can remember, but I can't remember what we did.
Yeah, like, Kchung's been great, I feel like, for me. Just, like, honestly, like, I think I made like some good work, some okay work, and like a lot of bad work on it, but it's been really, really good for like a lot of relationships my life. Like definitely like us, and you know, I hang out with Juan once a week.
That's a great, that's, if you can lock someone into that,
it's like
that's a special, some quality special time. Thing. That person really knows you.
Yeah, now I feel like we've been doing the show for 5 years, and we're seriously probably going to not be doing it a year from now.
Yeah, talking about that.
Just because it's like we feel like we've kind of explored the, like, a lot, and it's feeling...
There's been some nudity, even, in the studio?
Definitely been some nudity.
In the radio station?
Yeah, not in the new studio. I don't think I've ever got naked in there.
Basement. Oh, I definitely have.
I think maybe, oh my gosh, was I the first person to get naked on Kchung Radio?
It's not an impossibility.
Definitely not the last, though. But, yeah, so, like, now that we're like, I don't know, like, how do you, we're trying to figure out something that we could do instead of the radio show, kind of on a regular basis, that's, like, a big question that we have right now, is, like, how can we maintain kind of, like, some type of creative friendship or creative relationship that's, like, ongoing and maybe isn't, like, very product-oriented?
Sure.
But, still lets us have some fun art times.
Yeah. And,
How do you feel like this... This is operated for that.
This show?
Yeah.
I think it's helped me a lot in expanding my... Well, it's funny because I've never really cold called anyone I've never met before on this show, but at the same time, it's helped me get to know people that I would maybe normally never have a really long, substantial conversation with. And...
Because, like, we're good friends, but you've had a lot of people on that you maybe just, like, oh, you saw them, like...
I saw him do something I liked, and I got in touch.
Yeah.
And yeah.
Has that always been positive?
No.
No?
No. Someone came on the show, it's not positive when people cancel on me a lot.
Right.
Because I'm definitely at the point where I don't have a lot of free time.
Shout out to Victor.
I have a full-time job. And so, if someone cancels on me, like, 2 times, I get sad. I often find sadness in that. I definitely had a guest cancel on me 2 times, and then ask me not to air it.
Oh.
And that, I think, actually maybe even affected the quality of the show for a while, because I was nervous to ask hard questions, because I didn't want to have to delete the episodes. Which is a horrible outlook, really. Yeah,
that's not... I think you just have to run that risk.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what you gotta do.
What are the hard questions you wanted to ask me?
Oh, God. I don't know. I mean, I can definitely think of a lot of the intense moments of your life. Yep. That I would guess were really a lot for you. I don't know, man. Just the whole conversation around deciding you openly liked guys, you know?
Yeah.
Because that was a journey that I felt I got a little bit of a front row seat to.
I mean, I feel like that was, I think that was a lot weirder for other people than it was for me.
That's good to hear. That's good.
And the weird parts of it for me were about interacting with other people.
With those people.
Yeah. That was, because I had, like, fooled around with guys since I was, like, 19, 18, definitely by, like, 20, 21 in college.
Mm-hmm.
We've
definitely had our interludes.
And, I think it was really weird for people that just Like, I didn't really ever have a girlfriend or a boyfriend in college.
Okay,
and,
yeah.
And then I was, like, in a serious relationship for, like, a year and a half with a woman. And yeah. So, like, anybody that I met during that time, even, like, if I was, like, pretty close with them, they just thought of me as, like, a guy that had a girlfriend. So, like, of course they're straight.
Right.
And then, like, that ended for a lot of reasons. One of which I was just, like, kind of didn't want to be, like, I wanted to be, like, dating other people, at least in an open relationship, if not just single.
Yeah.
And then that relationship ended, and I think, like, one of the hardest times was, like, I thought I had been flirting with some guy for a long time, and he was totally, like, didn't realize that that was what
he was oblivious.
Yeah. And, like,
wow.
It got to the point where, like, after a long time, I was just, we were at, like, something, and we were kind of both on opposite ends of the room, and it was, like, wrapping up, and I was just, like, texting him, like, hey, do you want to go make out? And he was like, what? Like, don't you like girls?
Yeah.
And that feels really not cool, you know? Like, oh. Like, oh, so you actually weren't flirting with me? That was probably, like, the hardest time for that. But, and now it's kind of weirdly maybe full come around the other way, where, like, I would like to, like, date women, or now I'm, like, in a very, like, you know, this is 6 years later, I'm in, like, a great relationship with a guy, it's, like, an open relationship, and it's really easy for me to date other guys in a casual way.
Yeah.
But it's, like, kind of hard for me to date women. And
yes.
Like, at all. And, so that's kind of weird.
Yeah, I can hear that.
But, it's all right. I stay satisfied.
Yeah.
Most of the time.
You figure out how to make it work.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's, like, partly one of these things where, like, bisexuality or polysexuality, whatever, however you want to frame that, you never, like, see it, right?
You never see it, and it's never, valued in the same, it's still hard for people, I think.
Yeah, definitely. Especially for men. Like, or when thinking about it for men, and yeah, short of somebody, like, literally, unless you're, like, watching somebody have sex, you don't see it in the way that you see, like, a couple, and they're, like, holding hands, or they're, like, going to things together.
Yeah.
Right? But, like, yeah, with bisexuality, you can't really observe it in that way.
Yeah, and also I think, I know for me, I mean, things could change, but I pretty much am, like, I don't really see myself dating girls, and I think women are very lucky that I'm not trying to do that. But, I definitely said I was identified as bisexual
right.
first, which a lot of gay guys do that. Do that, and that kind of makes it hard for people who are legitimately interested in both genders or not interested in gender at all to be taken seriously.
Yeah. I do think part of that is, though, that they might be bi or whatever, but then
culture comes in
and like the systems in which people date, right? And like that it's just way easier.
Yeah. It's easier. It's easier. It's easier at the slumber party. It's easier at the
What do you mean the slumber party?
Well, like, you know, having come out in like ninth grade in high school.
Oh, so you would slumber party with the girls.
You slumber party with the girls, and then you sort of. How can I put it?
But were they ever like changing or something, and you were kind of like heating up? Like, we were getting turned on?
Getting turned on by nude women.
Yeah, like when you were that age and like you had.
I was
been
just
around,
no,
like...
no. No, I wasn't in that mindset right. of it really at all. I really just, but the thing was that my parents still weren't not, and maybe they were right. They were probably right in a way, but they were not comfortable with me having sleepovers with girls. But then in other family parental situations, they would rather me sleeping with the girls than the guys. But my parents would have rather me sleep with the guys.
Right.
Because I couldn't get anybody pregnant. That's the logic there.
That's pretty good logic.
So,
the whole thing is weird, but... Like, the whole thing is, like, coming out of fear, right?
It's decisions based in fear. Fear that teenagers will do sexual things that will get them in trouble, which is a legitimate fear. But it is a complicated one.
Or it's a thing that happens.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
All right. One hard question down. What's next?
I don't know. I feel like, you know, it's probably... You know, your dad passed away when you were pretty young. I mean, not a kid, but... I knew you at the time,
I think it was, like, 25, 24.
And, that was... I have no idea what that's like. Both my parents are still alive. And also, just... Maybe... It seemed almost, too, that there was, at the time... Still some family stuff about you not being fully out to your brother and maybe your dad before, and then you were with Anna. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I think my brother, it was a little bit, like, both my brother and my mom, like, I remember my mom a lot asking me, like, so are you gay? And being like, no. And then she'd be like, so you're straight? And I'd be like, no. And just having a lot of fun with that.
Yeah.
And like when I was in school and I wasn't in a relationship, like she wasn't meeting the people, you know. It was all kind of like, all like, it was very abstract.
Yeah.
You know, and my brother was definitely there for some of those discussions. But my dad wasn't. That is like a kind of, I mean, I should say my parents were both very like accepting and had gay friends, and like that wasn't, there wasn't maybe like a chance of receiving some kind of backlash that maybe that I've know people that have experienced.
Sure.
Right.
Sure.
And so that wasn't a thing, but yeah, I mean, my relationship with my dad in general was like, he had a lot of health problems towards the end and wasn't really all there, like, mentally.
Yeah.
And so that made that kind of whole time really hard, because it, like, he was just really different, and it's hard to, like, think about. To like, I don't know. It was hard to like engage with him in the same way.
Sure.
And it was big.
And you were very, also just because I remember you being at the time very, very private about the situation. Like, I think I was one of, you were not talking about with a lot of people.
Uh huh. Yeah. I don't really remember that. I mean, I will say maybe that, like, I'm a person that has a lot of acquaintances and maybe not a lot of really close friends.
Yeah.
And definitely, like, the last 5 years, that's been something that I've really tried actively to grow or to be conscious of, like, who and when and how I interact with people.
Yeah.
And I think at that time, it felt maybe really extreme. That was also, like, I feel like a time where I was going through a lot of transition, kind of, like, in terms of the social
the groups that I operate in, right? Where like,
well, you're leaving the sort of CalArts thing behind a little bit and becoming more in the LA thing.
It was like, but I mean, you know, like obviously there's a million things in LA, social things, and like, and even within CalArts, I had like my friends that I were like my peers in undergrad that were like I was living with at the time, but wasn't really like, you know, those people weren't, a lot of them weren't really like going to art stuff, and then I had like Anna's friends that were grad students that were going to a lot of art stuff, but I knew from school, but I wasn't really like friends with.
Sure.
And then like, yeah, meeting new people, some of which I'm still really close with, like Paul, you know, I met like right around that time, and or David or Young or a lot of folks. I mean, I feel like you're really the only person out of my like undergrad friends that I'm still friends with, you know, that I would like, to the point where like I would text if I was feeling really sad or something, or
yeah,
you know, in a crisis.
You said one of the most poignant things to me that anyone's ever said about people in art, which is that people in art have a bad time separating their friends, their career, and their community.
Yeah.
I still think about that in almost all my like social interactions, in a way.
Yeah. Because they're really different.
Yeah.
And like what you, how you like give and receive in those different relationships is all really different.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of people that are like have relationships that are really one thing, but they want to be another. Like they have community that they want to be a professional relationship.
Mm-hmm.
You know, or they have, or like, I mean, I've definitely had maybe like people in my network or community or whatever that I'd like to be friends with, but I'm maybe, especially when I was younger, I just didn't know how to make that happen.
Sure.
So that's all been like a learning experience, or that's been interesting.
Yeah.
Do you still feel like I'm a private person? I'm pretty.
Actually, I would say less. I would say less now than 5 or 6 years ago. But that could also, yeah, I would say less. Maybe that it's also, I don't live with you. Like I kind of, well, I guess I never live with you. I only live with you very briefly.
Yeah.
But I remember the 1 month I did live with you was where a lot of these different things were going on. And so I just remember thinking, oh, he's like a really private person. But that was because you were kind of still, I don't know, you were I don't know. That's what I remember thinking, but that was in like 2009, 2010.
Right.
So, no, I don't know. I don't think I would ascribe that to you anymore. No. Mm-hmm. And how long after, how long were you single before you, like, really single before you got
shacked up?
Before you shacked up with Michael, yeah.
I think 3 years.
Yeah, it was a while.
I think it was 3 years, yeah.
Yeah.
Because we started dating in 2013, and I think, yeah, me and Anna broke up in 2010.
Yeah. And you've been together for a long time.
3 years, 3.5 years.
Pretty impressive.
Yeah.
And Michael was also, who's also been on the show, I want you to listen
That's
to
right.
his episode. Michael is a scientist, biologist, doing stuff with agriculture.
Agronomist.
Plants. Agronomist.
That's my favorite label for him.
Do you like dating someone or being with someone who's not in art?
It's complicated. You know, sometimes it's really good, sometimes it's a little difficult. I feel like it, you know, it's kind of hard to say, because, like, would I, if he was the same person, but an artist, you know, like, is such a weird hypothetical question.
That's yeah.
kind of impossible to think about. He is the only person I've ever had. I mean, like I said, I haven't really had a lot of other serious relationships, but even in terms of, like, casually dating
yeah.
more than just sex, he's kind of the only person that is not an artist.
Yeah.
And, yeah, I don't know. I do think that, you know, there is a thing, like, a lot of science is about critical thinking, and, like, that has a lot to do with my art education.
Yeah.
But I would say the biggest difference is that, like I've talked about, subjectivity is a very, very large part of how I approach things. And I think that's, like, so important to art and everything, but he's much more invested in objectivity and, you know, like, the quote-unquote facts.
Sure.
And I kind of think that that's a little bit of a myth, but maybe it's real.
So, now another big creative project that you've been undertaking is closing.
Yeah.
Want to explain what that is a little
well,
bit?
Well, it's a... I mean, it's gone through a lot of different things, and I think it's going to continue. I'm really excited that we're doing a... we're publishing your collected writings.
It's an incredible honor, and it's an incredible achievement, really, to be in the process of publishing an over 100-page book.
Yeah, we, so a lot of publishing things. We're working on this set of photos that Fiona Connor made. That's, like, one of the other big things we're doing. This show for the 15-year anniversary of 9/11.
Let's talk about that, because you got Nicole Eisenman in the show.
That's true.
MacArthur Genius Grant Award winner, Nicole Eisenman, who's an amazing painter. Everyone really should look her up. What? How did you get that connection?
David knows somebody that works at her gallery, and at one of her galleries, and he asked him David asked his friend if he could forward an invitation to Nicole, and his friend was like, I'd be happy to forward this. She sometimes takes a long time to get back to emails.
Sure.
And we put the show together in like 2 weeks.
Very quick.
And he was like, alternatively, I own a work of hers. If you would like to show it, you'd be welcome to. And so, in some ways that was a lot easier because she lives in New York, right?
She absolutely does. Yes.
That would be kind of... We didn't have to, like, ship anything. It was a lot easier.
And what might Eileen Miles be doing for the show?
She's putting in two pieces of writing. One that's a short poem, and one that's a page from her diary, shortly after... from 2001. There's a couple works. There's hers, Devin Kenny's, and Vince Ramos's work was all made shortly after... September 11, 2001.
For those of you not familiar with Eileen Miles, she's one of the greats.
She's my favorite reader.
She's a living poet. She is loosely caricatured or portrayed by Cherry Jones in the show Transparent. I think that was one of the few times in my life where I was attracted to a woman. And you should all check out her writing and her stuff, too.
Really good writing. But yeah, she is hands down one of my favorite readers to hear read, whether it's her own writing or other people's writing. I've been lucky enough to hear it a couple times. And I usually don't think most writers make good readers.
Sure.
And I think that's maybe a big part of why they gravitate towards writing. It's because they aren't comfortable, like, verbalizing their words.
Yes.
She's an amazing reader. If you ever get a chance, you should.
I'm very lucky to say that I may at this 9/11 show. Or she's not reading at the show.
No. We're printing out her
printing
text.
Printing the text. There you go.
Yeah.
And what are some of the other works in the show?
Rosha Yagmai has, like, this pipe sculpture. It's like a rusted pipe that was torn out of a dilapidated building. That is like grounded in like a resin base and has like some parts of eyeglasses attached to it.
Yeah.
So there's a couple pieces that kind of like are the subject matter of the work is ruins or destructed buildings.
Sure.
There's a couple things that are more about like a kind of emptiness or like distance between things. There's a really beautiful cut up Time magazine cover that is one of my favorite things in the show.
Who's that by?
That is by Samira. I forget her last name. It's a really beautiful. She's like cut Islamic patterns into this Time magazine that has what's that called? The Osama bin Laden on the cover.
Yeah. I know that one well. Where were you? What was your relationship to 9/11 when it happened?
I was about to go to school, and my grandfather.
High school or middle school?
Samira Yaman is her name. That's it. High school. I was a sophomore. I was going to my philosophy class. My grandfather called me and was pretty distraught, and I was trying to talk to him, but I was also, like, late for school and was like, oh, I gotta get to school. Kind of, like, it didn't totally sink in what he was saying. I was thinking about it. I lived a block away from school, so it was just, like, walking, thinking about it. And then I get to class, and my teacher, her mom worked on, like, the 70-something floor, like, really high up.
Yeah.
And, so she was totally, like, upset, but trying to keep it together, you know?
But what did her mom passed away?
Her mom was okay. She missed her first. She was one of those people missed her first day of work in 15 years. Just woke up and was like,
I'm not going in.
I'm staying home today.
For no, just a complete gut instinct.
Yeah.
That is incredible.
Yeah.
That is really incredible.
Miss Christie was the teacher.
She was great. And she knew already at that point that her mother was safe.
No, she didn't.
Oh, God.
So, yeah, she was, like, trying to hold it together, but was, like, clearly, you know, dealing with some stuff.
I was in eighth grade, I remember when it happened, my grandpa was getting heart surgery, open heart surgery that day. And so we were very all worried about that. And my mom was sitting in the waiting room, and she just watched it, you know, because the first one hit and then the second one hit, and so then I remember they took us all out of class because you were a 3-hour delay, right. So it was early, but we were already in school.
Yeah.
So they took us all out of class and outside. I remember they took us outside of the building, which was so odd, and they explained what had happened to us. And I just remember this one kid in the class, he's same age as me, probably like 13, 14, and he just exploded, sort of. Like, he just was like, oh, like, we gotta kill them all, like, kill all the people in the Middle East, or something like that. I forget what he said, but it was just like, just this really, like, wow moment. Like, there are always these sort of,
That's how some people deal with trauma, is like,
yeah. And he'd been through a lot of trauma himself. His dad had recently died. Tying it all back together. And I just remember thinking, like, wow, I really don't feel that way, but this is how people feel that way.
Yeah, it's intense.
On the first, I know someone who it was their first day of grad school at CalArts was the day that 9/11 happened.
Oh, really? Who's that?
Adriana Jugovic.
Yeah.
And what happened there was very interesting. Charles Gaines took all the new grad students into the theater space of CalArts, and they all sat there, and he said, this is going to have the biggest effect on visual culture of, it's just going to completely change visual culture, is what he essentially said. Is my understanding of it.
Hmm.
which is not far off from the artist who said that that 9/11 was the most significant artwork of of whatever amount of time he said it was, but I think Charles said it in a less inflammatory way, maybe. But yeah, Charles Gaines, everyone should probably go check out his work. But yeah, it's kind of a sad note to end on, but it's definitely something that...
Yeah, I mean, I think partly we, you know, like, that's why... Partly why we wanted to do a show about it was, like, I think it is still really relevant. And I think a lot of the... A lot of things that are... That that event embodies, like... A lot of contemporary artists think about, and it's still a really big part of our consciousness or whatever.
Yeah.
Or something. I don't know.
Do you think... How... Because it had such an impact on our country. Because from where I was sitting, I saw a lot of a revival of an interest just in peace generally. From the Quaker side of it. But obviously on a more national level... It was a revived interest in patriotism and then
nationalism.
Quickly, war.
Well, I would say that that maybe in some ways is still, like, that's part of Trump, right? It's like this extreme nationalism and xenophobia.
Yes. I mean, I would venture that it it has definitely tinged the Obama presidency as well, in a not great way in terms of some of the drone stuff that goes on. But I'm not an expert on that, and it's almost—it seems almost impossible to be one. Thank you so much for coming on the show, John.
We didn't find. Did we find?
We did. We found. Did. We did that in the first 15 minutes, and then I just went around fighting some dragons that I needed.
And then
to fight.
You've just been flying around this tower just to kill time.
Or? Just to kill time, because I don't think we have. We had, I didn't think we had quite enough time after I fought that second dragon for me to go find another one.
Right.
But I got a lot accomplished in this episode. I will say that. Surely.
I'm happy. Thank you for having me. It's been a pleasure.
All right. I am Johnny Jungle Guts, and this has been another episode of Let's Gay. Stay tuned. We upload new episodes every week, and we're getting down to the big finale. The big final episode of this series.
What's going to happen in that one?
I think what might happen is I might invite everyone who I had on as guests before. I'm not sure they're all going to be able to make it. I'm sure I kind of hope they aren't because my apartment is not huge. And it'll just be a kind of a giant, confusing sound piece.
I meant in the game, but that sounds fun too.
In the game?
I'll try to come, yeah.
In the game, what's going to happen is we're going to save the world and also destroy magic.
Yes! Magic sounds cool though.
Yeah, that's kind of the bittersweet twist to the way this game ends.
Do you think that that's worthwhile? Like, is there no point of magic existing without the world?
I think that's true.
All right.
I think that I would choose the world over magic very quickly. There's also a beautiful... in many Final Fantasy games, we get into an existential conversation with the final boss about the meaning of life. And one of the main characters in this game talks about the meaning of life is to take something out of the moment in which you're living. And I think that that is something that's relevant to specifically fan and gamer culture, where people are fans just to be fans. And that's kind of what I like about the whole thing.
All right, there you go.
There you go. All right, stay tuned. Then.